afternoon, everyone. Shall we all rise? Father God, we thank you, Lord, for this afternoon. Thank you for giving us the strength to come before you. I pray that you'll sanctify our hearts and minds, our bodies, souls, and spirits, make them align to your Holy Spirit and your perfect will. Accept our praises, Lord, in Jesus' name. Kingdoms will bow down, and every chain will break as broken hearts declare his praise. Who can stop the Lord Almighty?
Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before him. So open up the gates, make way before the King of Kings, the God who comes to save is here to set the captives free. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. Stop the Lord Almighty. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? 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 Stop the Lord Almighty. Who can stop the Lord? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks chains. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before him.
Our God is alive,
the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow.
Seat for announcements.
I still have my jacket on. Welcome, everyone. Is there anyone that is new today for the first time? Would you be so kind to raise your hand? Yoo-hoo! We want to give you a packet, and there's a little card on top of it. Would you be so kind to fill it in? And you can hand it to Gerda, the lady who gave it to you, or to me, or to Darkia. Thank you. After the sermon, we would like to welcome you formally as well. Great. Kids Church. Kids Church is on the go again. And for the kiddies, that's 0 to 3. There's another one that arrived last week. So we have another baby in the church, which is great, and we're looking forward to more. But from 4 years on, they can join the kids' church. And from 4 to 12, there's two groups. And after the songs, you will go there with Gerda and Stefan today. Intercession, we always pray for. This is a praying church. I think most churches pray. Intercession is on every day, Sundays before church, 2:15 to 2:45. And you don't need to sign up, you just come, and then we pray for the sermon. And then on Mondays, we meet via Zoom, or you can come to our house and you can have some dinner with us. And then at 7 to 8, we pray together for what God has on his heart for his church, Shofar Utrecht. Next week we will also have a joint meeting with Shofar London. Once in 2 months we do that. Small groups, we share life together, and it's beautiful. It's really an opportunity to be involved more personally. So if you're not part of a small group yet, please sign up. You can do it online, but you can also do it at the back. I think there's also forms where the coffee and tea is. Sign up and be part of a group. You will be blessed, but they will also be blessed with you. As we always say in Shofar, we receive you as a blessing, and because you have gifts and things that God has put in you that no one else has. So you will be a blessing, but you will be blessed as well. Then we have a few dates. Save the date. I don't know if you want to make a note of this. Bible school, connect, evening, encounter, small group, leader training, global prayer and fast, encounter 2 and encounter 3. There will be more announcements closer to the specific dates. Bible school is starting tomorrow. So if you still want to do Bible school 1, 2 or 3, of course, you need to do 1 before you can do 2, and so on. Please register. There's forms at the back, or you can do it online. The first 3 sessions are free for the first years. But yeah, please, you need to sign up. Otherwise, I cannot send you the Zoom link. It is via Zoom. It's on Tuesday evenings. And mostly, it's on from 8 to 10. So we watch a video, we chat a little about it, then we watch the next video, chat a little about it, and then it's done. And then there's a small little assignment that you can do in your own time. It's really, I can just say it's, you will be enriched. It's something that you can take with. It's something practical. How do we do God practical? What is the different views on it? And it's really interesting. And the group tends to start to be like a small group online because you see each other every week. It's really nice. So I can just say there's not many that signed up for first year. So please, this is your last chance. Go for it. Life Encounter, 17 February. This is our first encounter. If you've never done encounters or you want to do it again, you're very welcome. This encounter is very basic, and as I always say, it is important that you know what type of church is this. And in encounter 1, you get a little taste of it. It's of course not everything, but it doesn't help you to sit here for 3 years and then you realize, I'm not in agreement with this or that. you missed your chance. Just come. It's also at our house, Zeist, me and Darkan's house. It's informal. We give you lunch, or you can order your own lunch on the list that we give you, and we will pay for it, just because you're so cool. But it's really informative about what do we need to be saved of, what does that mean, and if you know, then it's also helpful to come to learn how can you share that with someone. Now, if you ask someone, are you saved, what do you mean? So that's cool. It's also about baptism. As we know, many of us come from churches that do baptism different. So then there you can learn to know why we do baptism the way we do. And then also the baptism of the Holy Spirit. It is powerful. It's awesome. So it's really very, also very enriching. And you will grow. In this church, you grow. As most of you know, you're not just sitting on a couch. Good, then we have band. Yes. As you see, we are far from there. No? So I didn't say God told me that there will be so many, but God did tell me there are five more people. Five more people who need to sign up. We are starting a new group, so this is really the time to sign up, even if you need refreshment of your skills or whatever, it's now the time. So please join. We have, there's also a form at the back, or you can contact me, anything that is part of the band. We will have a band night on Friday, also at our house. It's informal. I will also do my best to have some food there. But you must not come for the food. You must come to enjoy togetherness. We practice a few songs, and if you let me know beforehand, I can send you the songs that we will practice. And just, I think they call it you jam together. I'm not so sure. Is that the word? So there's no syrup, but you jam together. Okay, so that is on Friday, but please sign up. There's still five more people. If God is speaking to you, or Holy Spirit is speaking to you, it's not that you will be serving every Sunday like Bem do and Greta do now. We want to have enough people to rotate. Yeah? But then you need to sign up and learn to know the rest. We welcome you eagerly. Then we'd love you to join us for coffee and tea afterwards. But then something happened. A few weeks back, me and Erkan went to Shofar, London, and to visit our children and grandchildren there. And the sign-up forms of Encounter 1, Encounter 2, Connect Evening, Small Group Leader Training, and I think even the volunteers' paper, the sign-up forms, disappeared. Okay? We can't find it. And no one knows where it went. So please, if your name was on one of those forms, would you be so kind to just sign up again? Because we miss you. We don't know who signed up, who didn't, and so please sign up again. That would be really appreciated. And I think offering message. What? I don't know what. Sorry? There's nothing more to read. Oh, no. Thank you so much. Sorry, there was a little confusion.
As I was praying for today's list of songs, one thing came to me, which is the question, what to you is the nature of God? And the immediate thought or answer was the three things that we know God is. God is omnipotent, He's all-powerful, He's omniscient, He's all-knowing, He's omnipresent, He's always present. But there's also one nature of God that rarely comes to, at least to me, and that's His naturally just good. And so I hope you'll join us in praising Him today with these songs that speak to the goodness of God.
Oh,
have poured out grace. You brought me out of darkness. You have filled me with peace. Giver of mercy, you're my help in time of need. Lord, I can't help but sing. Redeemer, you have set this captive free. Lord, I can't help but sing. Faithful you are. Faithful forever you will be.
Faithful you are.
Kids Church. Okay. Let's just pray together with the kids before they go out. Father, thank you for these children. Thank you, Father, that you've called each and every one of them into your house, Father, with a special purpose, that you love each and every one of them. Father, you are slowly building their characters, and you are molding them into being witnesses for you in their schools, in their play areas, in their sport teams. Father, thank you that you are calling them into your kingdom. Father, thank you that we have opportunity now to just to talk about you and who you are and the truth and the life and about you, Lord Jesus. And we just pray for them in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thanks. I see we are scattered all over. Could we maybe sit somewhere in the middle? Those who are back, if you can come somewhere closer, then I don't feel alone here. Thanks. Thank you. Anyone who received something during worship that you want to share with us? The opportunity is yours. Anyone? Okay. Shall we say a word of prayer before we start? Father, we thank you for today. We give you all the glory. We give you all the praise for this afternoon. Indeed, another day that the Lord has made, that we may rejoice and be glad in it. I pray that you will open our hearts to understanding, the standing of what you say to us in the name of Jesus. I refuse to speak of my own accord, for this will just be a motivational speaking. But when you are in it, Lord, it's life-transforming word. I pray, speak to us. May your word land in our hearts. We refuse to take it by the wisdom of our minds, for that is drying ground. Lord, we want to take it in our heart, in our spirit. The Lord, it will bear fruit, 80%, 100%. Lord, have your way. We pray, saturate this time with your presence. May your Holy Spirit take control. Take charge over everything. We shut down every other voice that is not your voice, Lord. We pray that we want to hear from you and you only. For in you, as Peter said, are the words of life. This is our desire this afternoon. To your glory, in Jesus' name. Amen. Yes, my name is Urbanus Kiio. For those who do not know me, I live in Vianen, south of Utrecht. And I have a wife and one kid, 5 months old. And being a father now, the topic of spiritual growth made a lot of sense to me, because I could see my son Emmanuel grow from when he was 1 day old to now that he is 5 months. And I can see a change every day. There isn't a day that is the same. You see growth in patterns, and you can be sure he's not where he was when he was 1 day old. He's growing towards maturity. I don't know what is the definitive maturity, but I thank God. And the Lord spoke to me that we need to have a discussion about spiritual growth, and particularly on spiritual maturity. And the basic scripture that I got is Hebrews chapter 5 and also Hebrews chapter 6. Chapter 5 verse 12 says, "In fact, though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you the elementary truth of God's word all over again. You need milk, not solid food. Anyone who lives on milk, still an infant, is not acquainted with the teaching about righteousness. But solid food is for the mature, whom by constant use of the have trained themselves to distinguish good from evil." And this is Paul speaking to the Jews and telling them, by the time you are Christ compared to now, I expect that there should be a change, notable change in your lives. But unfortunately, you are still the same, wanting to still be taught about the elementary truths and not the hardcore message about righteousness and truth. And in chapter 6 of the same book, the first verse, he says, "Therefore let us leave elementary doctrine of Christ and go on to maturity, not laying again a foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith towards God, and of instruction about washings, the laying of hands, the resurrection of the dead, and eternal judgment." And this we will do if God permits. And if you read at this, it's really scary, because Paul calls the things that are mentioned here elementary truths and doctrines of Christ. But I want us to look at what did he really mean, in essence. And I would think what Paul was trying to portray was, when you come to Christ, you are taught about repentance from dead works. And that is, you are alive when you are not in Christ, and when you are in Christ, you are in Christ should be different. And that you should not be falling back into your old habits. And he says also faith towards God. And these are basic things that you learn from the encounter one, instruction about cleansing and sanctification, laying on of hands to receive the Holy Spirit, or passing of gifts, resurrection from the dead, and eternal judgment. Because the church, there was a lot of contention about these issues, and he says these are for babies. So what Christ is expecting from us is like when we receive him, we start knowing about the elementary truths of the gospel, then we need to move forward. Not stay stagnant at one place. We move forward into deeper knowledge and understanding of who Christ is and what he has done. And Paul spoke to the church also in Corinth, and if you look at the characteristics of the church in Corinth, there was a lot of dissensions, a lot of disunity, there was a lot of competition for the gifts, because he talks exclusive about giftings and carnality. Because he explicitly says some men are even sleeping with their father's wives, and he calls that abomination. And in chapter 13, when he talks about love, the characteristics of love, in verse 11 he says, when I was a child, I spoke like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I gave up childish ways. In other words, he was saying like the things that you are doing are not from grown-up people. It is for children in Christ. Because there was a lot of fighting. I am for Paul, others were saying I'm for Apollos, others were saying I believe Peter is the main apostle. So there was a lot of disunity. Some were fighting about believing in the giftings of God, about speaking in tongues, about prophecy. And it was done not to build up, but it was done to for someone to get self-gratification. I am the best. God is using me. And he says, all these are for children. So what is the essence of the gifting? What is the essence of brotherly fellowship? Is that we come together and as somebody grow towards Christ. And while I was praying about this, I was asking the Lord, what is spiritual maturity? Because the word has been used so many times that it even became a cliche. So what is spiritual maturity? And what I will share here is not the exclusive or exhaustive, but I will share the revelation that I got about spiritual maturity while I was praying. And I felt that spiritual maturity is reaching advanced stages of spirituality, which encompass knowing who God is, what his will is, and believing in him. This leads us to perpetual transformation into becoming like him. The end goal of spiritual maturity and growth is becoming more like Christ. And I want to touch on few of these elements about knowing who God is, knowing what his will is, and believing in him. It may look very simple in the face value, but I can tell you like while I was praying, the Lord was giving me revelations that many people talk about him. They hear about him, but they really do not know who he is. So there's a difference between having a deeper revelation of who God is and knowing that he exists. It's different. Or he does miracles. But you have a personal relationship. God is very, very relational. And he wants us to have a deeper understanding of who he is. And I was quite shocked that you can be in God and you do not know him. Same way that I can walk with you, you can be my acquaintance, but you do not know me. If I do not open up to you, You know I am Urbanus. I live in Vienna, but you do not know me. But my wife knows me because she has lived with me. She has walked with me. We have been in fellowship together for long. So she understands. Sometimes she even tells me, like, if I ask you a question, I can always guess one or two times what you will say, because she knows. So I want us to look as simple as it is, who God is. I read from John 14:9. It says, Jesus was speaking to Philip and he said, "Have I been with you so long and you still do not know me, Philip? Whoever has seen the Father, whoever has seen me has seen the Father." How do you say, "Show us the Father"? So Philip was there, called an apostle, follower of Jesus Christ, but yet he didn't have a deeper revelation of who Jesus was, who God was. And I was praying and asking the Lord, how do we get to know you? How can we understand really who you are? You are so great. We are really small. How can we really have an encounter with you that will tell us about you? And I remember exactly 3 weeks ago is when I got this sermon, and it was around I think noon. I told my wife that we should pray. We were sitting in our bedroom and then we started praying, and around 10-15 minutes into the prayer I was carried in the spirit. So I was there physically, but I was not there. So they could see me, but I was not there. And I was taken to a place, I don't know where in the spirit, I can't say it was heaven, but it was a place in the spirit, and it was an awesome place. I've never felt so much peace, so much calmness, like everything sounded so perfect. And scriptures were running like as if in a big screen, and they were so clear, like you didn't need to struggle to understand what this means. And I was there around, I think, 5 to 10 minutes. And that's the first time I felt, actually, I could be comfortable in dying. Because it was, if that is the place we shall go, or if that is like a reflection of what we shall love when we go to heaven, then I really, you don't really mind going. And I've been praying for these 3 weeks, asking the Lord if I can have a little test again of that, because it was so clear, it was so perfect. The voice that was speaking to me was so clear, like a man talking to a man, and scripture that is difficult, then it comes, it passes like in a screen. And then I got this scripture about Jesus and Peter in Matthew chapter 16, verse 13, which says, "Now Jesus came to the district of Caesarea in Philippi, and he asked his disciples, 'Whom do people say the Son of Man is?'" In other words, Jesus was asking, "Do you really know me? Whom do people really say the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, others say Jeremiah or one of the prophets." And he said to them, "But whom do you say I am?" And Simon Peter replied, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven." So this is Jesus talking again to his disciples. Do you know who I am? Do you really understand who I am? And Peter, through revelation, gets the revelation of whom Jesus is: the Christ, the Son of the living God. And he told him, flesh and blood. In our own carnal mindedness, there is no way we can know God. If we are not filled by the Spirit or led by the Spirit of God, we don't have a chance. We can hear words about God. We can hear things that are said about him, the things that he does, but without the Holy Spirit, we cannot know who God really is. I don't have that scripture in the notes, but the Bible says in the book of, I think it is Corinthians 2:11, it says, who can know a man except the Spirit in that man? And likewise, who can know God except the Spirit of God? So God is a spirit. John 4:24. And those who worship him, those who seek him, must seek him in spirit and in truth. So we cannot overemphasize the importance of being filled with the Holy Spirit or being led by the Holy Spirit. And Jesus continued and said, I tell you that you are Peter. Do you realize that that was a name? Peter was a name that was given to Simon by Jesus in, I think, John chapter 1 somewhere. He called him Peter. His name, his real name was Simon. I think the son of Jonah. But Jesus gave him a new name. And I was getting a revelation that when we start to know who God is, he even changes our name and become again not the son of Kiio, but the son of God. And a lot of people who had an encounter in the Old Testament, in the New, you see like there is a change in name. What was the meaning of the change of name? It was an implication of a change in the inside, which was just revealed in the physical. It's like baptism. Baptism is just a sign. But it reveals like a change in the inside manifested in the physical. So Jacob meets God. He begins to understand the God of his forefathers. And God changes his name to Israel. Abraham's name was changed to Abraham, father of many nations. The one who had no child was changed to the father of many nations. Sarai, the barren, was changed to Sarah. Even see in the New Testament, Joseph, that was the guy who sold the land, was given the name Barnabas, the son of encouragement. So it signifies a change. So we begin to know God and something inside us changes. And we no longer see things the same way we saw them. When I had this experience with God, it really changed my perspective. I really wanted to, like, always pray in the Spirit, want to know God, want to have this fellowship. It was so good that I didn't want to miss anything about it. And I feel my life maybe will never be the same again since this day. And he told him, on this rock, and that rock is Jesus Christ, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. And we see he was given three promises. The first promise was the church belongs to God, and the devil can do nothing about it. So if you are a leader of a church, you have to worry because the devil can really do nothing about the church. This was a promise that was given to the first leader. Number two, he was told, I will give you the keys to the kingdom. And this is a wonderful promise. And number three, he was given the power to bind and loose. So there are some things that we can say if we are in God here on earth and they are established because we are in God. So we have power to decree and declare what will happen to Utrecht, and then they will be established in heaven the way wind clears them here on earth. And my prayer for us is that the Lord, most of the times he has spoken to us as shofar, that everyone is being given a key, that the Lord will give us keys to the kingdom, that we can open up things which are closed from God, closed gates, closed doors, that we can open them up from God. Keys to kingdom treasures. If you are mature, you can understand that treasure is not necessarily wealth of money. Even peace, tranquility, joy is all kingdom treasures. Wonderful, wonderful promises. And I feel the Lord is not able to trust you with all these promises if you do not make a deliberate step to grow towards maturity. It is the willingness to walk with God step by step that leads you to maturity. By the way, God is a gentleman. If you I normally see this in my local church in Kenya. You see some believers who have been there 20 years in church, but they're still the same, talking the same, feeling the same. They never change. They are like constant. It's very shocking. But the Lord is really growing, really calling us to place of growth and knowing him. So how can we know God? And I have two ways here which are not on the slides. And the two things that you should know to know God is, like, number one, I think Bem touched on it, you have to understand the nature of God. And number two, the character of God. The nature of God, he said them. God is omnipresent, he is everywhere. The Bible says that God's eyes are everywhere, looking here and there on the earth, in the heavens. He is omniscient. The Bible says that God is all-knowing. The Bible records that his understanding is limitless. He is omnipotent, all-powerful. He created the earth and the heavens by the word of his mouth. And then things to do with the nature of God, these are things that God cannot share with man. You cannot find it in man. There isn't anybody who is omnipresent. You are here, Mahesh, you are not in Marsen. So God is changeless. That's also his nature. The Bible says he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's constant through generation. He is self-existing. He was not created, but he created everything. And the other thing is about the Trinity. God Father, he is the Son, he is the Holy Spirit. These are things that cannot be shared with man. And you can find all of these in Scripture. The character of God, sometimes you find this one also reflected in people, like God is loving, God is kind, God is forgiving, God is faithful, God is relations. And these are things that we can be a copycat of God. And these are things that you start to manifest when you mature and you walk towards becoming like Christ. You start mirroring the character of Jesus. Jesus was loving, Jesus was compassionate, Jesus was generous. These are the characters of God. And I won't go on deeper into each of them. I want to move on to the second point that I was given. First one was knowing who God is. Number two is knowing the will of God. And I also have two ways in which you can know the will of God. Number one is to know the will of God as revealed in Scripture. The Scripture talks about a lot of things about the will of God. One notable is that it's not the will of God that any man should perish. That is very clear in Scripture, that God loves everybody, but he's calling everybody to repentance. Then the other way you can know the will of God is by his Spirit. So the Spirit reveals the deeper things of God. The Bible records that he takes the mind of the Father and then reveals this to us. So there is no shortcut about having the Holy Spirit in our lives. I usually tell people that respectfully, the Church of Jesus, which was left, was 120 people in the upper room. But when the Holy Spirit came, that day alone, when the Holy Spirit came, there was 3,000 people. So the church, I feel, belongs to the Holy Spirit. So a church without the Holy Spirit is like a car without an engine. It's going nowhere. Do you know the reason why atheism, I feel, is spreading so much and people don't believe in God? Is because we don't have the Holy Spirit. We are doing it very mechanically. And people look at us, they're like, this is not a true representation of what God is. I don't want it. It has no power. It is devoid of love. It is devoid of any life. So people want to see I want to see a difference. Is in Christ, yes. Is he loving? Is he kind? Why is he indifferent? Because of Jesus. And if you are doing it on your own without the Holy Spirit, then it doesn't work. It is mechanical works. It is philanthropy, I think. So we need the Holy Spirit to reveal. It became, if you read about the apostles, when Jesus left them, they went back to their old ways, fishing. When the Holy Spirit came, it was really easy for them to go on before the people who were persecuting them and telling them, this is Christ. So when the Holy Spirit was not there, they were hiding in the upper room. When the Holy Spirit comes, they face the authorities and tell them, choose between yourself whether we listen to you or we listen to God. And the Bible records that they were prepared to lay down their lives for the gospel. It wasn't possible without the Holy Spirit, because when Jesus was being arrested, they all ran away except Peter, and he denied Jesus 3 times. So, yeah, it's scary to live a life devoid of the Holy Spirit. And the other one was unbelieving in God. I have that Hebrews 11:6 says, for without faith, no one can please God. I'll read it. It is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists, and he is a rewarder of those who earnestly seek him. So God is imploring on us that we come from a point of hearing about God, knowing about God, to knowing who he is, to understanding his will. And when we understand this, then there should be a response that is evoked from within ourselves that I want to believe. Because then, if you don't believe, it has nothing. So you need to respond. And you respond by faith. Now that I know, I have to respond. I believe in God. And what is faith in God? It's complete confidence on who God is. So believing what God can do is really a small timepiece, but complete confidence on who God is. And Bible says without faith, it is impossible to please him. For you have to accept he exists, and he rewards those who seek him diligently. We have a whole chapter about faith in Hebrews chapter 11. Paul said that faith comes by hearing, I think in Romans. I don't have it on screen. And hearing by the word of God. So you hear what we have been talking about, and then faith is built in your spirit to respond to what you heard. So it's not about hearing anything. So you have to be very, very careful what you listen to. Is it building or is it abolishing? I have a problem with brethren who listen to secular music and saying that it has no harm. It has tremendous. If a simple song can be sung in a home and you feel the presence of God, then if a song is not inspired, then it has the same negating effect. So, what are you watching? What are you listening to? So, make it your ambit to listen to godly songs. Start with. It's difficult. I struggled with secular songs. I started deleting when I came to Christ, one by one, until I was left with one which was really, I was really addicted to. And I deleted it one day, and it stopped singing in my mind. And I lost taste of secular music. So what you hear builds your faith. So we need to firmly believe in God. So we come from a point of knowledge, because knowledge is just a fact that you have in your mind. But understanding is applying the fact. So you can have a lot of things about God in your mind. But how do you apply? Do you really believe what you are saying or what you are thinking? And we will look at the dangers of stagnation a little bit later. But I wrote something here. God wants us to move from a point of knowledge to understanding. And what does he mean by this? That, for example, you know that God is a healer and you are sick. Do you believe that he can heal you? So you need to catch that word in your spirit. He's a healer. We know he's Jehovah Rapha. But is it just a statement, or is something that you believe in your spirit? Isaiah said, who has believed our message? So that means like they already preach, and the expectation that they respond through the message by believing the message. And if you don't believe it, it doesn't work for you. That's why I say, in given two brethren, they started together in Christ, but one grows so much, and one scripture works differently compared to the other, because the level, the difference is the level of maturity. One understands and really believes, and the other one is a bit skeptical. If we were to analyze the word of God from a mental point of view, it is very illogical. So, and that's why when I prayed, I felt that your mind is like the drying ground, where the seed falls on the drying ground. But your heart, your spirit is the fertile soil. Because if you try to analyze it, it doesn't work. It really doesn't make sense. But if God says it, then you know he will do it. And lastly, my statement was saying, being transformed to Christ's likeness. Ephesians chapter 4, the Bible says, so Christ himself gave the apostles, the prophets, evangelists, and pastors and teachers to equip his people for the work of service, so that the body may be built up until we reach unity in faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God, and become mature, attaining the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. So that's the end goal of growth and maturity, to mirroring Christ, mirroring the character of God. And he said, then we will no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves, blown here and there by every wind of teaching, and by the cunning and craftiness of people in their deceitful scheming. So if you see an unbeliever who keeps on jumping from one church to another, trying, oh, there's no unity here, there's no peace here, I'm trying to find a place and say, oh, that's an infant. You, through the Spirit, should scan the spiritual atmosphere of the church and know, this is the right place that I need to be. So not, I've seen believers who are like that. Today I'm here, today I go to Catholic church, tomorrow I try Hillsong in Amsterdam. No. You need to have a church family that you are rooted to. You need to have a spiritual, I won't say father, a spiritual partner that you can work with, or a spiritual father that you are accountable to. It doesn't help. You realize, like, people who keep on, they don't grow. So, it says, wind of teaching and cunning and craftiness in their deceitful scheming. He said, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become in every aspect the mature body of him who is the head. That is Christ. So, that's the end goal, end result of growth and maturity in Christ. So, what are the dangers of spiritual match timing? So, when we were in high school, we were doing scouting for the, like, we mimic the military. So you are like, attention, then you match time. So it's the same place, but you keep on moving your legs. You're not moving forward, you're not moving backward. So there are some believers who are like that. They don't want to grow. They don't make deliberate action to grow. And here, number one, is that if we don't make deliberate action to spiritual growth, God can't trust us with some spiritual revelations. John 16, verse 12. The Bible says, I still have many things to say to you. This is Jesus speaking to the apostles. But you cannot bear them now. So if you are not spiritually mature, there are some things God will speak to you and you cannot bear them. So he better not speak them to you. For when the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you in all truth. For he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak. So he will declare to you the things that are to come. So even prophecies, because these are the things to come, they are not for the immature. So Jesus could have said a lot of things to the disciples, but they couldn't understand it without the Holy Spirit. So he chose to withhold until when they were ready to receive. And number two, we cannot receive the promises of God. And promises are many. One promise that he gives to the New Testament believers is the giftings of the Holy Spirit. Colossians 4:1-2 says, now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, does not differ at all from a slave, though he is the master of all. So Emmanuel is the heir of my estate, if at all I have any. But he cannot receive it when he is a baby. I have to wait till he's 18. until he is mature, he cannot receive the promise. He cannot receive the inheritance. So he has to mature up. So there, God has given us so many promises in him. So many. If you read scripture, it's expansive. The many things that the Lord has given us. But it's until we mature up that he can trust us with them. Otherwise, if you give a child something of treasure, the child doesn't know what to do with it. But he is under guardians and stewards until the time appointed by the Father. So, my prayer for us as Shofar Utrecht is that our treasures in the Lord, our promises in the Lord will not be given to others to steward them for us as the Lord is waiting. We want the promises now fulfilled. So, we have to grow, mature, that we can receive them. When the prodigal son was of age, I usually read scripture from more the perspective. I sometimes like him because he knew what was his right. He went to the father and told him, I need my inheritance because now I'm mature. And he was given. The other son didn't know how to say that. And he didn't receive anything. He was just complaining. But the prodigal son knew, yes, I am mature enough to get my inheritance. And the father could see that he was mature. And he gave him the inheritance. But he wasted it. So that's the other side of the story. Let us not go there. And number three, which is really heavy on my heart, is that we live a life that is not a representative of whom God is. And I touched about that, about atheism. They sometimes look at the church, the people in church, they are like, I don't think it should be like that. One day my wife was evangelizing to my father-in-law. It was telling him about Christ. And then he said, I'm looking at that church where you go. And I see some people doing them some things which I can't do, and I'm not an unbeliever. They are not mature. They are not a representation of who Christ is. And people look at them, they're like, oh, is that the ambassador? Then I don't want that kingdom. Because it's not a true representation. And I want us to look at the life of this man called the poor Lazarus. There was a rich man who was dressed in purple, Luke 16, and fine linen, lived in luxury every day. At his gate was laid a poor beggar named Lazarus, covered with sores, longing to eat what fell from the rich man's table. Even dogs came and licked his sores. This is one single representation of who God is not. So we read about a righteous man. Tick, tick. He was very righteous. In fact, he went to heaven. But here on earth, he lived a life that was not a representation of who God is. Number one, he was sick. Although he was a righteous man, so I put a caveat on him that he knew that God can heal him. But he didn't ask for healing. Even dogs came to lick his wound. So you can be in God and still suffer like someone who is not in God. So you need to mature up and know what God has promised you and have faith in him. So this man didn't do that, but he still went to heaven. Peter was asking Jesus one day, what shall happen to us who have left our families and followed you? And Jesus told him, you shall receive eternal life, number one. That's the most important. But number two, he said, 100% here on earth. So we are not called to live a life of misery. Sickness, disease, suffering is not the will of God. That is the devil. But you can choose if you want to call the God of heaven, believe in him for healing, believe in him for provision, believe in him for spiritual growth. But you can still choose to be laid back and not ask. It won't deny you from going to heaven, in any case, because you believe in Jesus. That is the ticket. But this man was a beggar. I wonder why he never asked God to bless him with something to eat. This is a life of misery, which I think is not in the will of God. So the rich man was rich, but he was not rich in God. So he missed eternal life. So we want to always check the story from two perspectives. What can we learn from this? So this is the one scripture that I was getting, that it's not a true representation of whom God is. And Psalm 82, verse 6 says, I said, you are gods. You are all sons of the Most High. Tick, tick, tick. All of us. Then it said, but you shall die like mere mortals. You shall fall like another ruler. We need to grow. And now God has called us gods. Then we live like gods. Jesus said, your scriptures say that you are God. The Son of God is a small God. So demons should not harass you because you are God. But believers can still accept to be manipulated by Satan. So you choose again. God says, I put before you life and death. Choose life. So then God gives us a choice to choose how we want to live as believers. We want to grow from one point to the other. So, brethren, the calling of God is that, number one, we will attain eternal life, and that we will live a life of victory in Christ. But we have to, number one, understand who God is, what His will is for us, and we have to believe in Him. It's a dangerous thing to walk with someone and you don't know Him. You remember when Jesus was resurrected, there were two men who were walking from Emmaus, and Jesus joined them. And they walked together. They were talking about resurrection and everything. But they didn't know it was Jesus who was with them. They even tell him, hey, are you a stranger in Jerusalem? You didn't know what happened. Jesus was like, okay, explain to me. And then the Bible says, he explained to them from the prophets, from the Old Testament, everything and scriptures that were written about him. But they still didn't get it, that it was Jesus. It was until they broke the bread that their eyes were open. So they were like, they were just used to a pattern, not God. So when Jesus used to break bread with them, and it was until he broke bread again that they were able to realize, it was Jesus we were speaking with. So let us not be used to a pattern of God, but know who really God is, not a pattern. We know that, when they are prayed to be filled with the Holy Spirit, they fall down. That's not a pattern of God. We need to understand who God is, that you can be filled even from your home. I remember the story of Jesus and the sisters of Lazarus, who was dead. So Jesus asked them, do you believe that your brother will rise again? And they say, yes, Master, we believe that he shall rise in the resurrection of the dead. But then Jesus tells them, the one you are speaking with is resurrection and life. So you can live a life of dead works while resurrection and life is around you, or you are living in him, but you do not know him. So It's up to us to desire to know him. To desire to know him. When I was praying that prayer constantly, Lord, I want to know you. Lord, I really want to know. It was when I was taken up by revelation. In my 15 years of salvation, I've never had that experience. And I knew then it makes a difference when you tell the Lord, really, I want to know you. I want to understand you from a personal perspective. And I always say, oh, I feel I always don't want to die young. But when I had that revelation of the peace, the calmness, the joy, everything packed in one place, I was like, maybe even if I died young, I would want to go that place where there's no sorrow. It was joy, happiness. So let it be our prayer today. God, help us to know you. And I put together from a summary of all the things that I was saying, and signs of a mature believer. The first one is spirit-filled, and not only that, is spirit-adherent. So you can be filled by the Spirit and still you hear what the Spirit is saying, but you deny the Spirit by doing contrary to what the Spirit is saying. So you need to adhere and be obedient to God. Second one is, we have seen that he strives to be like Christ. Number three, he bears the fruit of the Spirit. Spiritual maturity is measured by fruit, not giftings. A gift can be given a child. A child can even pray for you and you'll get healed because he has a gift of healing. But to bear fruit, love, joy, peace, patience, humility, self-control, goodness, everything, you have to be mature. That's where you realize in the terms of the fruit, there are some things that you still struggle with. Like in our small group, we were doing like, what is hindering you from really having that personal encounter with God, on God speaking to you. And people were sharing, I struggle with control to let go. I struggle with patience. I struggle with loving, like some things. And you could see that people are transisting, trying to mature up. If you give a gift to a child, they will waste it. So immature believers really use the giftings for their self-gratification. I've seen brethren who are really gifted in prophecy, very accurate, but their life is really different from what they... So if you take the gift away, then it will be an empty shell because they don't have any fruit. And Bible tells us clearly in Romans that the giftings, see Romans or Corinthians, the giftings of God are without repentance. That means like they cannot be revoked. Once it's given, it's given. But it's not a measure of spiritual maturity, unfortunately. The other one is that they are thoroughly taught and are teachable in the correct doctrine, not blown here and there by every wind of doctrine. We saw that. Show me a brother or a sister that is not submissive to teaching, then he still needs to grow. So we don't have to be hungry with him. We need to pray for him that he will mature up. And the last one is that they respect authority of God first, then his servants, and is open to correction, rebuke, or admonishment. And I see a lot of brethren really struggle with this in the Netherlands. I've shared with the leadership quite a bit of sometimes, and you hear someone was corrected out of love, and then they ask you, who are you, by the way, to tell me what I should do? It's fine, but that is a sign of a person who is not mature. Maturity tells you like God is above your culture. Your culture is like, we are all equal, you should not tell me, but God is above your culture. God has set people over you to correct you in love or to have a discussion with you. And if you cannot submit to authority, you can never have authority. So if you are not submissive to the authority of God, of Jesus, authority of the servants that he put over you, you cannot chase a demon because it will not listen. So they understand authority. We submit to God like that. We submit to authority that God has put, even if it's ungodly authority. Bible says all authority comes from God. So you need to respect your boss, even if he's not born again. You don't tell him like, you're not born again. You no. Set there by God. And we see brethren who served before kings, except for matters that were really against God. If your boss tells you to do something that's not godly, tell him, no, I cannot do that. But you respect him as the authorities that's there. Daniel, you see, they respected the king, but when the king said something that was against the law of God, then they would tell him, no, respectively speaking. They even tell him, oh, king, live forever. So number one, they tell him, you are a king, live forever, but on this matter, we have to give reference to our God. It's same with us. We respect them, but we are not afraid of them. Yeah. Yeah. So I want us to pray. In all those areas, the three areas, knowing God, understanding his will, and once you know this, believing, really, and living the reality of it. So if there's any of those elements that you struggle with, that you bring it to God and tell him to iron you out, to polish you, to make you like him as we grow. And let me make a final submission that no one has ever arrived. We are all in the process. So don't feel, if you feel like you are still in the stage of what we call the elementary doctrine, like of sin, trying to live some order, we are all growing. We are all growing. But what God doesn't want us to do is like stagnate. Today, there was a brother, there was a brother in the university, in our Christian union, that we were praying for, who was struggling with sexual immorality. And we told him, brother, the Bible says that you flee this one, you don't pray for. So we can pray for you, but you need to flee. So avoid those enticing moments and run away. But almost every Sunday we were praying for him to get delivered. Then I was like, I mean, you need to take action. You need to flee. So it was until he started like avoiding those circumstances, then he was delivered from that. So it was very draining every time you have to cast the same demon every day. Yeah. So I will ask to take the communion. And I will ask Christoph to play some sound on the background. If there isn't, we can just pray the way it is. So we take the communion, and then you go before the Lord. Yourself, you know yourself. You know which area you are struggling with. I know what area I'm still struggling with. That the Lord will really help us to grow into becoming like him. Father, we thank you for speaking to us, that you don't want us to match time at the same place, but that we grow and move towards maturity. And this maturity is with the end goal of becoming like you in Jesus. I pray for all of us that we will take deliberate steps to growth. The Lord, we will desire to know you, to know what your nature and character is, to know what your will for us is through your word, through your spirit, that we may believe you, having complete confidence in you, that we may believe what your word says about you, what your word says you can do with us and to our lives. Lord, I pray, help us by filling us afresh with your Holy Spirit. For how can we know a God so mighty, so great, without the Holy Spirit? The Bible says that you are spirit, and them that worship you must worship you in spirit. And Lord, we want to be worshipers who worship you in the spirit, desiring to understand you better, and walk perpetually in a relationship with you. Have your way in all of us, in all of us, and take charge in Jesus' name. Amen. Yep.
In communion, we remember what Jesus did for us on the cross. And as we took communion, I got reminded of Revelation 5, where it says, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing." And as we sing this next song, I just invite you to stand up and worship with us, and join the elders and the saints in singing that the Lamb is worthy, and that he receives all power and wealth and wisdom and might. Thank you.
Thank you for your presence this afternoon. We pray that you will bless this coming week. Cover us with your most precious blood. Surround us with your ring of fire and keep us from all works of the enemy. All this I pray to the Father in the name of Jesus Christ through the Holy Spirit. Amen. Bless your week.